Grade 11 pre-calculus notes for the 14th to the 18th of February. Of course, you can slow it down if you want. You can pause it. Control-Shift-S slows it down. Control-Shift-N puts it back to normal. Pause, rewind. Anyway, the answers, and they did work. The X equals 2 answer did work. And now we're back to some of this extra puzzle stuff I gave you in radicals and multiplying them and simplifying them. And sometimes you got to smash a couple radicals together and make them into another radical and then split them apart again into something that's, you know, a perfect square. So, just a little trick. And here's more of that extra fun puzzle that we gave with the radicals. So if you have 3nt to the fifth, the square root of all of that, times 12, n squared t, the square root of all of that, smash them together, and look how, ooh, you got some things you can factor out. You get some perfect squares, like 36, and t to the sixth is really just t squared cubed, and a few things I got. So just a reminder on lowest common denominators again. If you had 8 and 14 and you wanted to find the lowest common denominator, besides using the button on the calculator that does it, you break it into its primes, things that cannot be factored. So you end up with 2s and 7s as factors. Well, the biggest gaggle of 2s is 3 of them. So you write down 2 times 2 times 2. And then there was a factor of 7. So it ends up being 8 times 7, 56. Same thing here, 12 and 62. You break them down into their prime. You could do the table like on the right, but I think you'll find you're going to be up in the hundreds before you find some multiples that match up, some common multiples. So the smart way to do it is to break the 12 down into primes, so it's 2 times 2 times 3. And take the 62 and break it down into primes. It's probably like 2 times 31, I'm thinking. 31's a prime number. It doesn't appear in the times table. So you're going to take the biggest degree, or biggest gaggle of 2's. So there's 2 2's and 12, so you take them out. And there's, who's got 3? So there's only 1 3, that's the biggest group of 3's. And there's only 131, so you multiply all those together. 2 2's, the 3, the 31. Yeah, 372 is the lowest common multiple. And here's some more examples here. 45 and 50. Oh yeah, you got to go quite a ways to find the lowest common multiple in that too. But break one, each one down into its lowest prime numbers and multiply together the groups that have the highest degree. And there you go. You do the same thing with x squareds and polynomials and things too. All right, since x squared minus 1 is x minus 1 times x plus 1, that's the greatest, that's the lowest common multiple for all of them. Here's another one. What's the lowest common multiple for x plus 3 compared to x squared plus 6x plus 9? Well, notice that x plus 3, if I doubled it, would be 2x's plus 6. And if I tripled it, it would be 3x plus 9. And if I, what else did I do to it there? I could multiply it by, I don't know what I did in x, that other one. But I could multiply x plus 3 times x plus 3, and you get x squared plus 6x plus 9. So x squared plus 6x plus 9 is common, and it's the lowest common multiple to both of them. Not sure what I was doing with that x squared plus 3. Let's try it again. Just like when we did numbers, now we're using expressions, polynomial expressions. The left-hand one can be broken down into 2 primes, x minus 3 times x plus 2. The right-hand one can be broken down into x plus 2 times x plus 5. Neither of those can be factored any further. So you take the biggest gaggle of each factor. So x plus 2's, there's one of them. X minus 3s, there's one of them. X plus 5s, there's one of them. You multiply them all together, and you're going to end up with some huge, horrendous X cubed number. And we don't know how to handle X cubes anyways, so let's just forget that noise for now. All right. But there's the idea behind it. Hopefully something would cancel out in there so that it wouldn't really have an X cube. But we haven't learned how to solve cubes. And back to assignment, Charlie 8, rational worksheet. You guys are going crazy on this. You get way too excited. It is fun, though. So, the rule is you calculate, what's forbidden. And then you calculate the lowest common denominator, and then you multiply both sides, that's BS, by the lowest common denominator. And this one will be pretty simple. In effect, you're just cross-multiplying. Ooh, did I say that out loud? Cross-multiplying. In effect, that x minus 3 in the bottom right just pops up to the left, doesn't it? Right? You got a simple proportion like this. And I'm actually checking the answer there. Notice how I check the answer. We determined the answer was x equals 1 or x equals 2, and I checked them both. In purple up at the top, I checked x equals 1. And I checked x equals 2. They both work. You really do have to check the answers. Make sure you don't have any extraneous answers. And technically, you don't have to know how to graph things. In grade 12, you'll be doing this in your head. But I put them in the graphing calculator, and so did you, when we saw that it looked something like this on the right. So we saw that there was the two answers. It seemed to work. Let's try this one. Calculate the forbidden answers. X is not allowed to be 1. You're not allowed to divide by 0. Let's find the lowest common denominator. So X, I can't factor an X in anything. 4 I can turn into 2, 2, 6 I can turn into 2, 3. So you take the biggest gaggle of each, an X, 2 2s, and 3, and multiply them all together. Sounds like 12X is the common denominator. Because X goes into 12X 12 times, 4 goes into 12X 3X times, and 6 goes into 12X 2X times. Therefore, 12X is the lowest common multiple, or denominator. And so you multiply both sides by the 12x. Notice how the denominators magically disappeared. You gotta love that. And you end up with a simple, sort of like grade 8 linear equation there. In the bottom right, you solve it, and it ends up that x is negative 12. And you should really technically check your answer. And I did check my answer up there in green. It did work. Yeah, it worked quite fine. If you're not that good with fractions, just plug it into a calculator and make sure that it works out. Here's another one. Right? 7 is forbidden. The lowest common denominator is going to be 2 times x minus 7. They're already prime factors. Multiply both sides, the entire side, by 2x minus 7. So everything on the left gets multiplied by 2x minus 7. And right, each term inside that bucket there gets multiplied by 2x plus 7. Notice how a few things cancel out there. They go to unity. Notice how the right side simplifies down pretty nice to just a nice 10. And you have a quadratic. And it's pretty easy to factor this one. X minus 7 times x plus 4. Turns out your answers are x equals 7 or x equals negative 4. But check out up top. Remember, we agreed that x of 7 is forbidden. Therefore, x equals 4 is the only answer. Yeah, negative 4, rather. And we really should check that. Here we go. I'm checking it. 2 times a negative 4 minus 9, all divided by negative 11 there. Plus negative 4 over 2. And what does that equal? Well, you'll find out we did the rest just orally, but it does work out to be the same. So the left side is the same as the right side. Oh, actually, no, we did it here too, right? I went and we ran out of room there, so I did it here properly. So we plugged in the minus 4. Plug in the minus 4 wherever we see an x. And lo and behold, the left side becomes that negative 17 elevenths plus a negative 4 halves. So you need a common denominator. You need to know how to do fractions. If you can't do fractions, just check it on a calculator, for goodness sake, and make sure the left side comes out to be the same as the right side. Then we're back to reviewing our trigonometry now. This is midweek. Math 30S pre-calc. And we're going to be doing lots of this in grade 12. So I'll be sort of abbreviating this a bit. So we've been studying triangles, right, that go from 0 degrees to 90 degrees, and we haven't really looked at triangles that go beyond 180 or 215 or anything, all right? So we're going to start learning more about angles, and we're going to look at them inside circles. That's going to work out to be better. So we have this thing called a unit circle. So we assume that it goes all the way to the right to 1, 0, and all the way up to the y-axis at 0, 1. And obviously it goes to negative 1 on the left and negative 1 down. And we always measure angles from the positive x-axis on the right there, counterclockwise, CCW. And we're just going to assume, because it's easy to pretend you got a unit 1 circle, we'll just pretend the radius is 1 under many circumstances. Just makes it a little easier to calculate when you divide by 1. And so there we're setting up the unit circle. And what does that do for us? Well, let's have a look. Get your calculator out. Find sines and cosines of things. All right, so I gave you some angles there on the left, and I asked you to calculate the sine using your computer, your plastic brain. And don't go crazy. Just draw them. Do them to 2 decimal points. And those are the numbers you came up with. All right, so you were, and if you graph them on a circle, notice the triangle's inside a circle, provided that the hypotenuse is just the length of 1, and we call that the radius as well, since it's inside the circle, I think you'll be able to see, well, the next slide, that sine is really just the opposite side, or how high up you are on the circle. So sine is just how high up you are on the circle. Now we give our circle quadrants, the different, the four quadrants, different names. So quadrant 1 is the one we often operate in, and we're just positive. So everything's positive there, x's and y's. Quadrant 2, your y's are positive, your x's are negative. Quadrant 3, you got negative x's and negative y's. Quadrant 4, you've got, what have you got? Oh, you got negative y's and positive x's, all right? This will become important later when you're doing sines of angles and you're trying to remember, you know, what angle you're talking about, because you might be in different quadrants, okay? And then we actually graphed in some, we eyeballed in some angles, like 20 degrees and 50 degrees and 120 degrees and 330 degrees. We'd done all this the day before. How do you graph 385 degrees? Well, 385 degrees is just once around the circle and another 25 more. And how do you graph negative 30? Well, you just go backwards 30. Now here's the good day, backwards 30. Now here's the good day.